anywhere in America, this would be considered a major college athletic facility. In fact, the NCAA might say that this is a premier college athletic setting. The NCAA also tells us that only one out of every 10 American high school athlete, boy or girl, will ever find their way to a college setting like this. And that is a hard reality. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner, a program which attempts to address those realities. Join us, won't you, as we discuss issues and topics both informative and provocative. Good evening, everyone. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this, once again, is the Inside Corner. The topic this evening is a newly acquired definition of competition. Did you get that? A newly acquired definition of competition. We have with us this evening, we're really privileged to have them. Their time at home is rather limited, and they've been unselfish about giving us an hour or two this evening. We have with us two LT graduates, presently cadets at the United States Military Academy at West Point, namely one Jackson Whitcamper. Jackson, good to have you.
Thank you.
And David Carlson, his classmate, not only at LT, but at West Point. Did you know that in this area, there are five recent candidates at the United States Military Academy? Did you know that? We have, namely, Brian Barker, 2004 graduate of Nazareth Academy. We have Cadet Nate Drake, LT class of 2005. And then, in 2006 from LT, there were really a record number of cadet candidates, namely, of course, Jackson Whitcamper and David Carlson, but another young man, Cadet Patrick Magnuson, class of 2006. So in this immediate area, there are five West Point cadets. This is highly unusual. It is highly unusual for one school to have three West Point candidates in one graduating class, and that was a distinction given to us by Whitcamper, Carlson, and Magnuson in 2006 at Lyons Township High School. So, Jackson and David are here with me this evening because I think now, after one full year at the Military Academy, they might have a different perspective about how to define competition and what it means to be competitive, as opposed to what they experienced in high school or in grade school, for that matter, or in life in general. You have to admit, don't you, that life in general is not the typical... is not the typical run-of-the-mill experience at the Military Academy. Life in general doesn't exist at the Military Academy. It's an altogether different experience. I want to know from them if now, after a year's maturity, after a year's tenure at West Point, if they have a different perspective on what it means to really be competitive. Is that fair enough?
Yes, sir.
Okay, very good. You know what? What were your motivations? Your original motivations for going to the Military Academy? Why couldn't it have been U of I, Champaign-Urbana, or Notre Dame, or Duke? Because you guys were very good students, weren't you?
Yes, sir.
Jackson, what was your class rank at LT?
I don't remember. I think it was like 50 or something like that.
50th in your class.
Something like that.
And your ACT score and all that? What was that like?
That was kind of average. 27.
27. Did you take the SAT?
Yeah, I don't remember what I got on that. Sure.
And David, what about you?
I was up there too. I was in the 80s, not quite as high as Jack, but I think my ACT was at 30.
Really?
Around there. So
I think Nate Drake was seventh in his class.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
And I don't know about Magnuson. I'm sure he was.
Yeah,
you have to be, right?
Yes.
You have to
yes,
be.
Sir.
Okay, now what? You could have gone just about anywhere, right? I mean, U of I certainly wasn't out of your reach.
Right.
Northwestern, probably not. Notre Dame, maybe. Those are great schools. Mm-hmm. Why did you choose the military academy? What were your motivations?
Well, for me, well, for both of us, always wanted to be in the Army. Always wanted that to be our career, my career. And I wanted to serve as an officer. So, I mean, I heard about West Point, about fifth grade, and how tough it was to get in, how much of a challenge it was to get through. And I just wanted to test myself. I mean, I wanted to be in the Army, and that's what I wanted to study. I mean, I wasn't interested in studying other subjects, so kind of rules out other colleges.
And by the way, your major right now at the military academy?
We don't decide till next year, but I'll probably
what's
do
likely to be?
Either history or military science. So I just wanted to test myself, see if I could make it through 4 years, mm-hmm. and got 1 year down so far. So,
David, what about you?
Yes, sir, very similar to that, the challenge, definitely. Academics was not the big pull. I mean, they are a great school yep. for academics, but mainly it was that uniform, knowing I'd have a career serving in the United States Army. Yep. That's the main draw for me, ever since fifth grade, both of us.
Really, that early?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Were you guys friends in grade school and high school?
Yes, sir.
Really? No fooling? Yeah. Yeah. And did you share these ideas about the military academy then when you guys were in fifth grade, seventh, eighth grade? Did you?
Yes, sir.
It goes back, sir, yes. Yeah.
Oh, my God, that's remarkable. Because the chances of getting in the military academy are
that was.
Let's face it, realistically, they're pretty slim.
That was in the back of our minds the whole time.
Yeah.
How are we going to get two in there? And happen to be three.
Can you imagine that? And not only did you get both of you guys in, but then Magnus in there too. And Drake the year before you. That's four from LT in 2 years, or 3 years. I told you before we were on the air that I was at LT for 30 years, and the only other West Point cadet that I recall was in either 1970 or 71, prior to Drake, in 2004. So, wow, I mean, so this is a remarkable thing. You guys used to fantasize that you would be cadets one day.
Yes, sir.
Together as friends.
That's it.
That's wild. That's really hitting it on the head. I mean, you guys are, you got to be good at everything in order to have that happen, not just lucky. Okay, so your original motivation was a childhood ambition.
Yes, sir.
And service in the Army.
Yes, sir.
Studying military science. What's going to be your major, David?
Probably some sort of engineering, leaning towards civil.
Civil engineering.
Yes, sir.
And you have a foreign language curriculum going now, right now?
Next year it'll start.
What will it be? Arabic?
Arabic.
And yours is?
Russian.
Russian.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Wow. What's the daily regimen like? I know sleep deprivation is a hobby. The military can. But give us a rundown before we discuss your newly found competitive attitudes. Give me a rundown of what your typical day is like.
Well, what time are you up?
Well, it's a little bit different for plebes, the freshmen, because they have to do a lot more. I usually wake up around 5:30. I don't know what time.
Is that right, Dave?
I get up at 6.
On average, I mean, it changes. You obviously want to get as much sleep as you can squeeze in.
What time are you in bed?
I usually get to bed about midnight. That's when lights out are.
Really?
Badly. Yeah. I'm a little later than that. That's why.
Really? So you're working on 5 and 6 hours sleep?
Yes,
you're
usually.
Operating on and maybe less sometimes, 4.5.
Yeah, it depends if you stay up, if you got a lot to do.
And that you're up because we have studying?
Duties in the morning as plebes. Those include delivering newspapers to all the upperclassmen, taking the upperclassmen's laundry outside to get it picked up. Let's see what else. Cleaning
the
bathrooms, taking out the trash.
Sweeping the halls. And it all has to be done by, supposed to be done by 6:15. So that's why
that
we have to wake up
next year?
That's over
yes.
with. That comes with this year.
So next year's guys have to do that now.
Yep. Yeah. And okay, so you're never in bed before midnight. That's lights out.
Well, you can be. I mean, if you finish what you need to do before, then you can go to sleep whenever you'd like. But
is it quiet enough at that hour to get to sleep?
It's quiet. It's
how many roommates do you have?
I have two.
I just had one.
Just the one. Are you guys in the same, do they call them dormitories or barracks?
They call them barracks, sir.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Are you in the same one? You're not in the same one?
No.
We're like across the post.
Okay.
Yeah,
so. All right, so you can get to bed as early as you wish. Mm-hmm. But 12 o'clock midnight is lights out.
Yes, sir.
You're up no later than in David's case, no later than 6, he's pushing usually at 6. Huh? You do these menial tasks, and then what happens?
And then we have breakfast formation.
6:55?
Yes.
It's formation. Before that, I mean, you got to get your... We have to clean our rooms. Every day our rooms get... Well, it's supposed to be every day our rooms get inspected. There's certain room standards.
Who's inspecting them?
Upperclassmen, cadets. Upperclassmen?
You guys like Nate Drake?
Yes, sir. 1 or 2, 3 years older than us.
Yeah. So
but Drake never inspects your barracks.
No, he's in a different company than us, so we don't really see him.
No politics there. Okay, so you're inspected. Your room is inspected every day.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Excuse me. When you're doing these tasks early in the morning, the cleaning of bathrooms, the delivery of laundry, the delivery of newspapers, rather, and the organization of upperclassmen laundry, how are you dressed?
In the uniform of the day.
Uniform of the day?
Sir, we got to be presentable. Can't go out inside our rooms without that.
Okay, so, all right, so when the tasks are over and you report for breakfast, is that correct?
Yes, sir.
There's no need for change of clothes?
No.
Okay. All right, so now you're at breakfast.
So that's about 20 minutes.
20 minutes.
About 20 minutes.
Is breakfast in silence?
No, it's...
is there a regimen at breakfast?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
There's a posture, there's a procedure, correct?
As plebes, that's another fun task that we have. We have to memorize all the drinks of the upperclassmen, have those set out correctly, announce all the beverages, and just...
you have to arrange the condiments in height order on the table.
You have to know the menu?
Yes, we have to know three meals in advance.
When do you find time to do this?
That's why we stay up till midnight.
So you're memorizing the menu the night before?
I usually do it in the morning. After we do our duties at 6:15, we have like from 6:15 to 6:50 to do all the cleaning.
Right, there's no competitive aspect involved in this. I mean, this is an obligation.
Yes.
You don't get merits for having done the menu recitation better than the other cadet, do you?
You get, like, you're competing for military grade too, especially first semester.
Oh, yeah.
So this results in a grade? It's the laundry, the bathroom cleaning,
the newspaper delivery,
and the memory of the menu results in an evaluation?
It's just overall military bearing, how well you can do that.
And does it matter that your evaluation is better than the next guy's?
Yes, sir. It goes into your class rank.
It's part of your class rank.
Yes, sir.
This is pressure.
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. So you have memorized the menu and the beverages. You spit that out. And then what occurs? This is all within the 20 minutes of your breakfast.
Yes, sir. We have to wait until everybody else is served, and then the plebes will announce, like, if there's a dessert, they have to cut the dessert and ask how many pieces people want. And then when everything's done, the plebe at the bottom of the table has to say, sir, ma'am, the fourth class cadets at this table have performed their duties and are not prepared to eat.
Sir, ma'am. Don't forget this. There are ladies there too.
And then they'll say, go ahead and eat, and then you can eat.
Okay. And you're throwing food down at this point, correct?
It depends.
Now maybe
the
you have 10
good.
Minutes.
10 minutes, and then.
Okay.
7:35, class starts. And
what time was breakfast?
7 o'clock.
7 o'clock it starts.
7:35, you make your way to class.
Yes, sir.
No, it's a big campus. Campus isn't even the word.
Everything's walking distance.
Do they call it the campus?
Post.
Yeah. It's a big post. And you have to make your way from your very brief breakfast, where most of which was duties, you've rapidly eaten, and you make your way to class at 7:35.
Sir.
What if you're late?
Well, that also goes into your military grade. You get your TAC officer, which is the actual commissioned officer in charge of each cadet company. He'll get a report from your instructor that you were late for class, and then it's his job to decide the disciplinary actions taken from there.
Okay. The typical punishment is called hours. and for being late to class, usually it's 5 hours.
Have you ever been late?
I don't think I have.
Have you been late?
No, sir.
What's the punishment?
It's called hours.
Hours.
For being late, it's usually 5 hours, which is the minimum.
5 hours of what?
Physical? No. You go out into the central area between all the barracks, which is like a common area.
Right.
And you're in your uniform with all your rifle and your belts and stuff. Everything has to be nice polished. You get inspected. And then however many hours you have, you just walk back and forth for 5 hours.
So you get 5 hours for 20, maybe you're late 20 seconds. 5 seconds, a minute.
Depends on your instructor, how lenient they are.
He may let you slide?
Depends on how you've been doing in the class, I guess.
Really?
Yes, sir.
Do plebes slide less or more than upperclassmen?
Probably a little more.
A little more.
As you...
They slide more.
Yes, sir.
They're given an adjustment time.
Yeah, by the time, yeah.
And all the plebes are in class together. You're not in there with upperclassmen, are you?
Not usually.
Okay. Okay, now you've been to class. How many hours of class?
Morning classes go from 7:35 until, when does it end?
11:54.
Yeah, 11:54. And, I mean, there's different periods. So you might have an off class, you might not have a class a certain period, but there's certain periods during that time. Some people have all those periods filled. Some people only have, like, two. It all depends. But just go to morning class, a lot like high school. Go to class and go to lunch. Lunch is the same type of thing as breakfast.
Same regimen for you. Mm-hmm. Same tasks. Right. Memorization of the menu, resuscitation of the menu. You eat when they tell you you can eat.
Right, sir. So,
have you been to the bathroom yet in between?
Yes.
When do you do this?
There's bathrooms in the hallways. I mean,
yeah. And that's time. That's
right. You gotta. That's part of learning how to be, an officer, managing your time, being efficient.
Okay. In regard to the class, inside the class, we're going to talk about the academic regimen, and if there's any competitive aspect there, we'll talk about that in the next segment.
Okay.
But I want to build the case now for the competitive pressure and whether or not now you have a new idea as to what real competition is. Maybe it's less intense. Doesn't sound like it to me. But we'll be right back. We're going to take a break now for public service announcement. My name is Terry Sullivan. This is the Inside Corner. We're discussing a newly acquired definition of competition with two West Point cadets. Please come back. You're watching channel 16 or 99. Come back right here. We'll be waiting for you.
The headlines howled the news. Someone had to find the key to that trunk, and that someone was I, Detective Ike LaRue. A cat burglar. Of course, the library, the perfect place to crack open a good mystery. I expected a cat fight, but instead she rolled over like a playful Pekingese. Mystery solved. Join the summer reading program at your local library. You can't imagine the treats in store.
Thanks for coming back, everyone. Once again, my name is Terry Sullivan, and this is the Inside Corner. We are discussing a newly acquired perspective on competition with two West Point cadets, namely Jackson Whitcamper and David Carlson, 2006 graduates of Lyons Township High School. We're at Now Serving Cafe and Catering in LaGrange, a place that lets us in every once in a while, and we're happy to that, and our thanks and appreciation to Paul Link, the owner. We were discussing their daily regimen in the last segment, and now we're getting closer to asking them about the competitive aspects that may have changed their whole opinion about what real competition is. Not just that in the athletic column, but we'll talk about athletics too. So I wanted to ask you about the academic regimen. Again, now, the class day begins at 7:35, you go to about noon. You have lunch.
Right.
You go back to class.
Yes, sir. Just like high school.
Just like high school.
About 1:50. No, afternoon classes. Around 4.
Yeah, classes end at 4.
Yeah.
4 o'clock.
4 o'clock.
Wow. How long is lunch?
Same thing.
20 minutes. Filled with your tasks, and then finally you're allowed to eat. Okay. So you go back to class till 4. Okay, on a test day, you take your tests, whatever they might be. How often do you have tests? Is there just midterm and then final?
Well, at the academy, they don't call them tests. They call them WPRs, which they acronym for everything.
Yeah, it's the Army.
Written partial review. They happen after, actually, quite often.
There's usually three
to
per
four
semester.
Per semester.
Three semester. Do they post those grades?
Yes,
they
do.
Post them.
Yes,
by name?
Depends.
Depends
on your
serial number.
Yes, we do.
You do have a serial number.
They usually do it by that. If
so
they
post it by your serial number outside the classroom door?
Sometimes a lot of things is done by email.
Yeah,
so they'll email it out.
Oh, they'll email
by email. Yes, sir.
But everyone actually has it. They email to your personal email address in your barracks room.
Yes, sir.
So the general population cannot determine what grade you got. Publicly, they can't determine that?
Unless they
sometimes
know your number, yeah, sometimes.
But they can get an overall feel of how the class did. So
how?
Like, the teacher will send out a spreadsheet with everyone's score on it by number, so you can kind of see how you stack up against everyone else.
Guys carry that around, cadets carry that around, and they share it with each other. So it's no different than high school.
No, yeah.
Right. What I was looking for is whether or not they post your grades in a hallway someplace with your name next to it, which would add to the competitive pressure, would it not? All right, but they're not doing that.
No, they're not that public.
Okay.
Yeah, they're not.
All right. Surprising. So you have your WPR.
Yes, sir.
Your written, personal.
Partial.
Partial reviews.
Partial review.
Yes, sir.
They're not tests, okay. They have to have an acronym.
That's right.
Your written partial review is about three times a semester in each course.
Right.
Okay. On exam day, on WPR day, the final WPR, what's that day like?
Well, the WPR is usually administered after lunch. After lunch is usually a free period, like to do homework or if you have a briefing to go to that. But WPRs are usually after lunch during that free period. So you go in, it's a typical length class period. And depending on what class it is, I mean, it's usually either, like if it's chemistry or a math oriented class, it'll be about five problems of just, you work them out, they kind of take a while, you have to show all your work, all this, like high school.
Did you take, what math did you take at LT?
I was in the pre-calc.
Pre-calc?
Yes, sir.
So was I.
So were you. Did it prepare you for what's going on at the West
Definitely.
Point?
Definitely.
Yeah, I did pretty well.
But it's a lot different kind of how they did it. A lot of it is free thinking, like you have the math concepts, all that kind of stuff, but there's a lot of problem solving. They focus a lot of that because they know in 4 years or 5 years from now, once we're out of here, that's what we're going to be doing.
That's what you're going to be doing, right.
It's problem solving.
All right. So, class is over.
Class over at 4.
4 o'clock class is over. Now what occurs?
Athletics.
Athletics.
Mandatory athletics.
Mandatory athletics.
Every cadet
is an athlete. Is that the motto?
That's the motto.
Every cadet an athlete.
Every cadet challenged, yes. That's
every cadet is challenged.
That's just what it is.
Of course, every cadet has passed a physical. Every plebe has passed a physical before they enter the academy.
That's right.
At Great Lakes Naval Training Center, right? You went there for your physical?
Yes, sir, that's where I went.
All right, now is there another physical after that? Because if everyone's going to compete in athletics, don't they all have to be in shape? And
so,
right?
Yeah, before you even get there, they do a physical
CFT
test, yes.
Yeah. Candidate Fitness Assessment, or CFA. Yeah.
CFA
is it pretty rigorous?
It's just typical Army stuff like push-ups, sit-ups, pull-ups.
And the ladies, the females, go through the same regimen? No adjustments for the female?
They do. They have, they have lower maximum push-ups, sit-ups. Uh-huh. And I don't know what their pull-ups are for that.
Yeah,
I think they can do flexed arm hang.
Right.
If they want. But then once you get in, it changes to the APFT, which is the Army Physical Fitness Test.
Yes.
And that's just push-ups, sit-ups, and a 2 mile run.
And you're evaluated there again.
And that was our first grade, actually.
It seems to me like every place you turn, you're being evaluated.
Yes, you are. You get a military grade, a physical grade, and an academic grade.
Okay. And this is far more competitive than what you experienced in high school. Because you're not being evaluated every minute of the day.
Right.
Right?
Plus, everyone else is pretty good, too.
Right. I mean, these are top-notch individuals from all over the country, even from all over the world, right? Because there are cadets from foreign countries,
right,
who will go back to their armies,
yes, sir,
upon graduation, and their governments are paying the United States government,
right,
for training.
Okay. Yes.
All right, so from all over the world. All right, now every cadet is an athlete. Wow. What's, you have a choice of sport?
Yes.
Huh? Croquet or?
No, not at all.
What, you have your choice?
Yes, sir.
From a long list, short list?
There's two seasons for intramural activities. That's if you're not Corps Squad, which is...
two seasons in the year.
All right, sir.
Okay.
And they're pushing to make three.
Is it fall and spring? Or
yes, sir.
Fall and spring.
Fall and spring.
What did you do in the fall?
I did biathlon.
Biathlon?
Yes, sir.
Swimming and running?
Just biking. About everything. We did running, rucking, which is running with the
right,
the backpack.
Backpack.
And
how,
shooting.
How heavy was the backpack?
I'm not sure. It wasn't too bad. It was probably only about 25 pounds.
Okay. So.
And just about everything, obstacle courses. And we did pretty good on that, our company.
Yeah.
You challenge against all the other companies in the Corps. Which
are
like
you in
32.
The same company?
No.
No. Separate regiments. Too.
That would be another unbelievable coincidence. Two guys from fifth grade now in the same company at this point. And what athletics are you involved
in? I did intramural football, and then we both did this thing called Sandhurst.
Yes,
explain that, Sandhurst. Is
it's,
that a little bit more competitive,
yeah,
to get into that?
Definitely,
yes. Definitely more competitive.
Yeah. Wow. That's pretty big. It's a military competition. And they call it Sandhurst because teams from the Sandhurst Military Academy
in Great Britain?
In England, yes, yeah, come, as well as the Canadians and... they used to have ROTC teams and like Navy, Air Force, and mm-hmm, teams. And we had a team from Afghanistan too this year, which was pretty cool.
Really?
But what it is it's just a military competition. It's like an eight-mile course.
Yes.
Eight-mile course, and you run it in your full gear, you know, helmet, boots, rifle, all that. And it's through the woods, pretty much.
Females are involved in this?
Yes, each team has to have one.
Any adjustments, any accommodations for them?
No.
No.
Not at all.
Same as the males?
It. Sir.
Are you carrying a pack?
Yes. Well, there's two packs. One has a radio in it, one has a rope in it. And they have, I mean, you switch off whoever carries those. And there's just different tasks along the way, like gas mask run, grenade throwing, shooting.
Live grenades?
No, they're just...
Dummy
yeah, throwing them at a target.
Blank ammunition?
No, it's live fire.
Live ammunition.
Yes, sir.
All right.
There's a ranger wall, which is like the big wall that you see people pushing each other up on. You got to get everyone over that.
Did you have any firearm experience before you went into this military academy?
Oh, a little bit.
Did you, David?
Yes.
Hunting or something like that? Target? Skeet shooting?
Yeah, trap.
Trap.
Both
all right.
Of us.
All right, so go ahead.
Obstacle
course.
Yeah, there's like obstacle type things, river crossing, just a bunch of different
Are you
events.
Doing this in a team?
Yes.
Team of 10.
A team of 10.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So there's more than one team in a company, of course.
No, each
no?
company just has one team.
One team from the company.
So you compete to get on that team, and then...
Are they all plebes?
No, there has to be at least one cadet from each class.
One upperclassman cadet.
Yeah. There has to be at least one freshman, sophomore, junior, and senior. And you can mix it up however you want, but it's pretty it's a big week.
How many in a company?
About 130 cadets per company. So
the other 120 company members didn't make it into Sanders.
If they tried out,
right.
Well, not everyone wants to do it, but
not everyone wants to do it.
Right.
But if they're not doing Sandhurst, what are they doing as a substitute?
There
are
other
sports.
Spring intramural.
Another sport instead of Sanders.
Right.
The spring intramurals are, what are they? Soccer?
Basketball. Grappling.
Yeah, grappling.
Grappling.
Football again.
Football, handball.
Yeah.
Okay. So. Okay, see more about Sanders.
It's pretty, I had a lot of fun. I liked it a lot.
Awesome.
But you get timed. Your overall score is your overall run time, how long it takes you to get through the 8 miles, so you're running the whole time.
How often do you do this 8 miles?
It's just once. One day, yep.
But there's practice and rehearsal every day.
It's a long season.
Yeah. It starts,
how long is it?
We started in November, actually October, and the competition was end of April.
Okay, so it culminates in a one-day competition.
Right, yes, sir.
After all that training.
Mm-hmm.
All right, now when you win it, what's the privilege? Did your group win it?
No, we did pretty well, though.
What, is there a placing?
Yeah.
What place did you come
from? We got six.
What about you,
David? Our team got, I believe, 16th. So out of 40.
If you win it, what's the privilege?
Well, usually the Canadians win.
Why?
They're pretty tough. Just their military academy is different. They're a lot older, and
I see.
They're more military.
They're older.
They get to train a lot more than we do, but that's not an excuse. But
yeah.
That's just how they do. They've won the past couple of years, but it's pretty much bragging rights.
It's just bragging rights and notoriety.
You get a trophy, but...
Yeah. But for you guys, though, is this part of an evaluation someplace? Since you're required to participate in a spring sport,
right,
and you chose Sandhurst, is it part of an evaluation as though the spring sport might have been?
Yes,
it takes place.
It goes into your physical grade. How well you do.
This isn't a hobby thing.
No.
This is another evaluation. Someone's writing down notes about you and giving you a grade, so to speak.
So to speak.
Oh, my God. It better be fun.
It is.
It's a lot of fun.
It's good. So the lead Sandhurst is an upperclassman officer.
Yes.
That's it.
The lead of your Sandhurst.
Squad leader.
What's that rank usually?
That'd be...
Our guy was a cadet lieutenant.
Yeah. That's what I was supposed to
do. Was Drake involved in this?
He didn't do it this year.
He's on
sprint football, so
he's like
a varsity guy.
Right,
so.
Yeah. Can you explain what sprint football is?
Sprint football is just, it's pretty much everything. It's 11 on 11, full pads. It's real football. It's
real
just,
contact tackle
right,
football.
Right, yes, sir. But everyone has to be under like 175 pounds
right,
or something.
And they travel
like that.
And play other schools. Right.
Yes, sir.
Not just the other military academies,
right.
They play other schools. So it's a limited weight, limited size.
Right.
Full contact football.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Do they get graded for that?
Yeah.
They do.
Yes. It looks good.
Okay. Oh, my God. All right. When you arrived there, did you have misgivings? What am I doing here? Did you say that to yourself?
It was...
Are you saying that to yourself? No.
No, definitely.
No, that's great.
Definitely love the place. Right.
Yeah.
Right.
But, yeah, that's...
I'm glad to be home.
It's nice.
Yeah.
To catch up on a little sleep.
Yeah. Exactly.
But that first day was pretty fun.
But you, the first day, this is where you shake hands with your parents and you become government property.
That's right.
That's it. You sign in.
You sign in and you're sworn in.
Sworn in.
Yep.
That's it.
Okay. Did you have any misgivings?
Not really, actually.
No. So you guys have been thinking about this since fifth grade.
Right.
Yes.
Could you tell by the behavior of others that they had misgivings?
Yes. That first day is pretty... It's
fun.
You know, what you think about when you go, you know, a lot of upperclassmen yelling and, you know, people
you're
doing...
You're being hazed.
Yeah, people doing push-ups and, you know, screaming and stuff like that.
I want to talk about the hazing later.
Okay.
Okay.
I want to know about this first day when you noticed others have misgivings. Were there those who broke down?
Yeah.
Definitely.
People who cried and I think some kids quit the first day.
Some kids didn't even show up. Like...
They didn't show up the second day, they went home.
A guy in my squad, never saw him.
Again.
I never even saw him at all.
After all he went through to get into the academy,
it's surprising.
He took a walk.
Yep.
I mean, you have to respect that.
It's a free world.
Right.
And there's a whole world out there beyond the academy. And I guess we can't be too critical of that.
Right.
But
right.
Evidently, the competitive atmosphere washed him out soon. All right. Well, we have to take another break here. And for public service announcement, but we're going to address in the next segment the effect of hazing on these two cadets and the intensity that lent to the competitive atmosphere as we define for you a newly acquired definition of competition. We'll be right here waiting for you in 1.5 minutes or a little bit more. My name is Terry Sullivan. You're watching 16 or 99. Thank you.
The world has changed a lot since 1970. That's when Congress created the Securities Investor Protection Corporation, SIPC. We'll be right back. For 37 years, we've remained focused on one thing: helping investors in the unlikely event that their brokerage firm encounters difficulty. We've helped more than 600,000 investors recover over $14 billion in assets. We're the Securities Investor Protection Corporation. There for you then, here for you now.
Thanks for coming back. My name is Terry Sullivan, and this once again is the Inside Corner, and we are at Now Serving Cafe in LaGrange. And thank you, Now Serving, for letting us in once again. I have with me two cadets from the United States Military Academy at West Point, namely Jackson Whitcamper, 2006 graduate of Lyons Township High School, and his classmate David Carlson, also a 2006 graduate of Lyons Township High School. We are discussing their newly acquired perspective on competition. They just told me in the break that the first semester at West Point, no television allowed, no movies, DVDs, videotape, no video games the first semester. Afterwards, there's a loosening up on that. Yes, so everyone has to play a sport.
Yes, sir.
Right.
And you have to play two a year, and you chose Sandhurst, this particular military competition of groups of 10 against other groups of 10. Mm-hmm. A military training which takes place over a period of about 3 months before it culminates,
yes, sir,
in the Sandhurst 8 mile, what do we call it? Obstacle course?
Course. Competition.
Competition. And they're graded on that also. Everything's an evaluation. All right. What you haven't discussed, and which it's an image that the general public has of our military academies, and you haven't mentioned it. Maybe it doesn't exist. Maybe we've been propagandized by the media. I don't know. I've never been to West Point. I'd like to go, but I've never been there. It's only what I have read and what I have seen in motion pictures. Sorry, my ignorant way of understanding your experience. But in every one of those media presentations about West Point, they seem to emphasize the hazing and the pressure placed upon, particularly upon plebes, freshmen. Is there or is there not hazing?
It's not hazing. They really changed their philosophy over the past few years on hazing. It's become more of the physical to the verbal.
As a lot of physical as opposed to emotional or psychological pressure.
It's shifted more to mental pressure than
more
physical.
More to mental pressure? Give me an example.
Well, a lot of yelling, I guess, especially during our summer.
People right up in your face?
In your face,
sir.
Are they degrading you? Are they calling you names?
They're not names. Not
really. Yeah, they're very limited by what they can do,
what they can't do.
Yeah. Another thing they do is, we talked about kind of at the meal, plebes are required to know this thing called knowledge, which is like famous speeches, weapons criteria, like ranges, rates of fire, I don't know, just
trivia
songs. Yeah, yes. And we have to know, you know, word for word, and they'll just come up and, you know, like, you know, recite this right now.
Yeah, do it, right?
Schofield.
Then you have to do it.
That's
and
right.
If you don't do it, what happens?
Just
push-ups?
Yell at you. Yeah, they can give you push-ups. You know.
But the tone is not encouraging. When you don't do it,
right,
or even if you do it correctly, whatever they're demanding of you, mm-hmm, the tone is critical. It's pressure, is it not?
And it should be.
It's designed to be that.
It should be, exactly, yeah. As an officer in combat, you have to be able to perform under pressure.
Right.
That's what it's all about.
I mean, this isn't the Moose Club, you know?
You need that. It's not a bad thing.
You've got to be able to perform under pressure. So they're challenging you every day with pressure.
Exactly.
Right.
So they want to know about a weapon. Tell me about such and such a weapon. Give it to me now.
Right.
Is the attitude, right?
Sir.
And if you don't come through with it, there's a detriment.
That's right.
And what might it be? Physical.
Could be push-ups.
Physical is one side. And also, you can get reports, cadet observation reports, which are written by a cadet on to another cadet if they mess up. Duties might be reciting that knowledge.
This other cadet can be a second year guy?
Yes.
Could be.
Or lady?
Yes.
More likely a junior or a senior?
Yeah. Right.
Yeah.
So
they write you up.
Basically.
Because you didn't know what. What's the most trivial thing you were asked that you stumbled over?
Let's see. Probably a meal. Meals, I mean.
You know, so this was in the mess hall?
Yes.
Yeah. Were you ever stopped on the way to class when you had to get there and you had 3 minutes to get to class and some upperclassman stops you and he wants the drill from you?
Well, maybe. Not really that, because they usually have their places to go, but another thing is greeting. You have to greet upperclassmen, and if you don't greet them, then they'll stop you, and they might ask you a couple pieces of knowledge.
Greeting is, how does it go? What does it sound like?
Well, if it's before a football game, then you'd be like, beat Baylor, sir, ma'am, or sergeant, and so, and if you mess that up, or you walk right past them, they'll notice that, and they'll stop you.
So it's more than a, is it a salute?
It's not a salute.
You don't salute cadets.
No, you don't salute cadets.
But it's a greeting.
Yeah.
It's to get you used to saluting a real officer later on.
So that's the extent of the hazing.
Another thing they can do is give you writing assignments. Like if you don't know the max range of, or if you don't know the meal maybe, they'll say, okay, write out the meal 500 times and give it to me before lunch or whatever. Right. So
before lunch.
Or
but
whatever.
You're in class.
Well, I don't think they're supposed to do it during the academic year. They did it during the summer training.
I see. So that you're giving me the extent of the hazing. It's so, mental, a little emotional, some physical, some push-ups or whatever, running perhaps.
It's all to motivate you just to perform. I mean,
but it's not name calling.
No.
It's not degrading.
No.
Do males haze females?
Yeah, no distinction.
Yeah, there's
pardon? No distinction.
Nope.
And females therefore haze males.
No distinction.
Yes, sir.
Everybody's hazing you. That's what it amounts to. Right?
Yep. That's right.
Now this next year, is that going to improve for you?
Yeah, we're
lesson
done with
we're upperclassmen, officially.
That's it. So now you get to do it to somebody else.
Right.
Are you anxious to do it to somebody else?
Actually, mainly, our job next year is actually to be kind of mentors for the underclass, plebes, as cadet corporals. Right. That's our job.
All right. If you weren't mentors, would you be required to haze?
That's mainly third year. As our
third year is required to haze.
Not necessarily required to haze, but to...
It's certainly the tradition. Right?
Well, it needs to be done. I mean...
Yeah.
And that's, like you said, that's what distincts a military atmosphere from anything else. And you have to learn that. I mean, a lot of kids coming in just out of high school, just like us, I mean, we've never been under pressure and exposed to that. And that's what combat is. So that's what you need.
Okay. So I guess we've come to the central question. Do you have an entirely different opinion about what competition really is?
I definitely do. I mean, during high school, I played sports. We both played sports.
You played football and track.
Yes, sir.
David was in cross country and track.
Yes, sir.
And obviously, you know, there's competition there. Beat the other guy, win. You know, win conference, win state, that type of thing. But just coming into the military, it kind of puts a new perspective on it because there's not really any greater competition than fighting against someone else to the death. I mean, that's basically what the Army's all about in combat. And when you get second place in that competition, you're dead.
Yeah,
so
it's a good point, isn't it?
Yeah. So I mean, losing. I mean, whenever I lose in a competition, whether it be Sandhurst or football, or if I do poorly on a test or something, I always kind of think on the back of my mind, like, you know, man, if this was combat or whatever, that's. I mean, losing's not good enough.
Yeah.
So definitely puts new stakes on it.
Does yours change? Your opinion change about what real competition really is?
Yes, definitely. Along the same lines, one of the things we actually memorized during Beast was on the fields of friendly strife for sown the seeds, which upon other fields, on other days, will bear the fruits of victory.
Yeah.
So that exactly what he said right there. Like what we're doing here now at the academy, training Sandhurst, is really just the start of something else. Like we're going to use that someday.
Yes, you are. And very practical.
Yep. And also just being part of a competitive team. I mean, that's what you're going to do when you graduate, too.
Yeah, that's another thing. Has the team concept changed for you?
Definitely.
How? I mean, you were on the football team at LT, cross country at LT. Mm-hmm. there's definitely a connective bond on those clubs, right. High school sports. How has that been altered? How has your team concept been altered?
Well, everyone there is trying their best to improve themselves, but at the same time, you have a team that you're, especially Sandhurst. Sandhurst was, I think, the biggest change for me because, yep. I mean, everyone's there. At the end of the day, you're completely wiped out, but you just look around and you see on everyone's faces that everyone's here for a purpose. Mm-hmm. And you're just driving towards
that. So there's more of a sense of oneness?
Definitely.
You're experiencing more of a sense of unity definitely. Than you did in high school sports?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, you're living with those guys yep. in the barracks, and especially since it's a company team. Mm-hmm. You see them every day. You go to the mess hall with them. I had two other plebes on my team, and they went through the same things I did every day with just corrective training and everything like that. So you form a bond yeah. that's just
And so, therefore, you definitely feel there's more at stake in the competitive atmosphere world at the military academy than what you experienced at stake against Hinsdale Central.
Oh, right. Plus, in high school, I mean, you're on a team, especially a team as big as cross country or football. Yeah. I mean, you have people have their own little cliques within the team, and you might have that couple guys are just kind of screw offs or just there to be there. But I mean, even just one person in the academy or in the army like that, you can't have that because that affects the whole unit, the whole team. And I mean, when you're, again, you have to always think about when you're in battle, and you got to be able to trust that everybody will pull through and everybody will pull their weight.
Do you think you have encountered anyone at West Point, because they're from all around the country and even foreign countries, have you encountered anyone at West Point, male or female, who you have identified as having a non-competitive personality?
Yep.
You think there's some there?
Yeah, I have.
Mm-hmm, definitely.
Have you observed them this year? Did you observe them change in terms of their competitiveness? Did their competitiveness increase? Or did they kind of go on accommodating it, pushing it away, staying in the background of competitive settings? What about the non? Is it possible to be non-competitive and succeed at West Point?
It can exist. I don't know if
you can exist.
Can't exceed.
You can't succeed. You can't stand out. So,
I mean, there's definitely people that kind of have the wrong attitude. Or they just get turned off by like, oh, this is stupid. You know, I'm not going to do this. And
are they found out somehow?
I mean,
through body language, through being overheard, through their insubordination.
Because they're usually the people that stay in their room and, do their homework and stuff. Everyone else is out doing duties or, doing stuff. They don't like to help people. So they are not very widely liked in the company. And
are these people disciplined because of it? Have you seen that happen? Have you seen an attempt on a part of the academy to weed them out?
Well, they can be written up, like he said.
Yeah,
like other cadets, at the end of each semester, we're required to do assessments on like at least three cadets or something.
Yes.
So if you know someone like that, you can do an assessment on them and say, hey, this person is not pulling their weight. And then that goes to the tactical officer who issues the military grade. So it does. It reflects on your grades.
It does.
Definitely.
Wow. So it's the wrong place for someone who does not want to step up and give their best shot.
Right. Because the Army, you can't be that way in the Army either.
Yeah.
And in terms of the team concept, much more intense than high school athletics or college athletics. Much more intense, a lot more bonding. You feel as though you're responsible for the next person next to you.
Right. Definitely.
More so than you might have felt on your high school athletic team. Now, we expected that answer. Here, let me ask you this. Will you feel this way 3 years from now? What do you think?
Hopefully, because by then we'll be graduating and we'll be going into the most dangerous team there is.
Right, because if you don't feel that way 3 years from now,
right.
You still have how many years ahead of you? Four? After your...
It's five.
After the academy, it's 5 years.
Right.
of commitment.
Sir.
So it will either be imbued in you by that time, or you will have accepted it personally as beneficial to your personality and character.
Right.
If you haven't, how are you going to make it through 5 years of commitment?
Exactly.
So right then and there, that just points to the ultra-competitive atmosphere and environment.
I mean, especially coming out as an officer from West Point, I mean, as that officer, you're in charge of whether those people, I mean, the decisions you make can kill people or make people live. I mean, that's not a motivation.
So this is a little bit more serious than worrying about whether or not we're going to beat Hinsdale Central.
Right, exactly.
Hey, it was really good having you, honest to God. And I hope there are a lot of young men and women out there listening or playing sports to realize that there is another level. And maybe you can arrive at that level where you are right now. Maybe you can push yourself to that level. In terms of your bonding and connection with teammates, in terms of your loyalty and dedication to the task at hand, because there are those your age that are experiencing it firsthand. They're pushing themselves and purifying themselves in terms of the competitive spirit. It's quite a commitment. Jackson, thanks so much for giving your time.
Thank you for having me.
David, thanks so much for giving your time.
Thank you, sir.
LT is proud of both of you. This community is proud of both of you. Same goes for Magnuson and Drake and Barker. Proud of you all. God bless you. Please be careful. Get home as often as you can. My thanks this evening to David Carafa and Matt Perilli in the truck and Tyler Nelson in the truck and my cable station coordinator, supervisor, Mr. Bill Allen, my director, Mr. Tom Sklarski. I'm forgetting some others, I'm sorry to say, but nonetheless, thank you for watching us this evening. My name is Terry Sullivan. This has been the Inside Corner, and we'll see you again soon.